Let us see the location of the liver. The liver occupies the right hypochondriac region, the upper part of the epigastric region, and little bit part of the left hypochondriac region. Okay. So this is the extent, it is the location of the liver. Let's see the external features of liver. Liver is actually the largest gland present in our body. Liver has got two lobes, a large right lobe and a small left lobe. You can see it's a large right lobe and it's a small left lobe. Okay. Liver has got surfaces and borders. Okay. So it has got five surfaces and one prominent inferior border. Okay. So what are the five surfaces? It has got an anterior surface, which is in the front. Anterior surface, this is the anterior surface. Okay. There's a superior surface, there's a posterior surface, then the inferior surface, where all the viscera will be related, that is the inferior surface, then a right lateral surface, These are the five surfaces. Again, we'll revise the surfaces: anterior surface, posterior surface, superior surface, and inferior surface, which is the visceral surface. Okay, then the right surface. Okay, then the right surface. These are the surfaces of liver. The liver has got only one prominent border. This is the one. Okay, this is actually the inferior border. You can see this anatomical portion is the inferior border, which is very prominent. All other borders are blunt. We can't consider that as border. Only the inferior border is well defined, which will be separating mainly the anterior surface from the inferior surface. And also it will be separating the right lateral surface from the inferior surface. Okay. That is about the inferior border. If you see the inferior border, it will present two notch. You can see there are two notch. One which is the notch which is present between the right and the left lobe of the liver, and other one which is present along the fundus of the gallbladder. You can see this is actually the gallbladder. Okay, so this notch here is called the cystic notch, and this notch here, it is called as interlobar notch. This notch is called interlobar notch, and this notch is called cystic notch. So inferior border present two notches. Okay, next we will see how to hold the liver in anatomical position. If you see, this is actually the inferior vena cava opening. You can see this is actually the inferior vena cava opening through which the forceps is passing. This inferior vena cava opening should be perpendicularly placed. It should be very straight. Okay. When you hold, it should not be like this or like this. It should be straight. Okay. This is how the liver has to be holded in anatomical position. Inferior vena cava should be straight. Now let's see the lobes of the liver. Okay. This is the right lobe. This is the left lobe. The right lobe is very large. It will occupy almost 5/6 of the liver, and the left lobe is small and it will occupy only the 1/6 of liver. Okay. Now these two lobes anteriorly, it is separated by this ligament. This is actually the falciform ligament. And if you go inferiorly, these right and left lobes are separated by this ligament and the groove, which is associated with this ligament. This is actually the ligamentum teres and the groove for the ligamentum teres. Okay. The groove for ligamentum teres. If you go more posteriorly on the inferior aspect, you can see this is another groove. Okay. This is actually the groove for ligamentum venosum. This is groove for ligamentum venosum, which is going more posteriorly. Okay. So this entire right and the left lobe is separated anteriorly by the falciform ligament and inferiorly by two structures. One present anteriorly, that is groove for ligamentum teres and the groove for ligamentum venosum inferiorly. Okay, that is about the separation of right and left lobe. Now if you see the inferior surface and the posterior surface of the right lobe, okay, it presents two more additional lobes. If you see only the right lobe, large right lobe, it presents two more additional lobes. One on the posterior aspect, you can see near the inferior vena cava, you can see along the posterior surface, you can see this additional lobe. This is called the caudate lobe. Cauda means tail. Since it is on the posterior aspect, it is called caudate lobe. Okay. This is called the caudate lobe. C-A-U-D-A-T-E. Caudate lobe. Then, if you see anteriorly on the inferior aspect, this is the inferior aspect of the liver, you see called the quadrate lobe. This is called the quadrate lobe. So these two are the additional lobes which are present in the right lobe of liver. Now we have to know the boundaries of these two lobes. If you see the boundaries of caudate lobe, it is bounded to the right by inferior vena cava. We can see this is the inferior vena cava, and it is bounded to the left, okay, bounded to the left by the groove for ligamentum venosum. This is the groove for the ligamentum venosum, okay. Then if you see superiorly, it is continuous. See, superiorly it is continuous with the right lobe, okay. And if you see inferiorly, if you go inferiorly, it is restricted by the porta hepatis. This area is called porta hepatis. Porta hepatis is just like the hilum, okay. It is actually the place where the structures enter or leave the liver, like hepatic artery, portal vein, all these structures are present in the porta hepatis, okay. So that is about the boundaries of the caudate lobe. Again, we'll revise. The right, it is bounded. The right, it is bounded by inferior vena cava. To the left, it is bounded by ligamentum venosum. Superiorly, it is continuous with the right lobe, and inferiorly, it is bounded by porta hepatis. Okay. Next, we'll see the boundaries of quadrate lobe. Quadrate lobe. Okay. Quadrate lobe. Okay, is bounded anteriorly by the anterior border of the liver. So this is actually the inferior border of the liver. So anteriorly it is bounded by the inferior border, not the anterior border, inferior border of the liver, okay. And to the right it is bounded by, see, the fossa for the gallbladder, okay. Right, it is bounded by the gallbladder and the fossa for gallbladder. To the left it is bounded by the, see, the fissure for the ligamentum teres. This is the ligamentum teres and this is the fissure for the ligamentum teres. Right and the left boundary. Now posterior, posterior boundary is by the porta hepatis. Posterior boundary is by the porta hepatis. Okay, anteriorly by the inferior border, posteriorly by porta hepatis. To the right by the gallbladder, okay, and gallbladder fossa. To the left by the ligamentum teres, the groove for the ligamentum teres. Now if you see the caudate lobe, inferiorly it presents two features. One is this elevated region towards the left side, okay, here on the posterior aspect of the left side. This elevated region is called the papillary process. And if you see, it is continuous with that of the right lobe inferiorly. Can you see this one? This is the continuation with that of the right lobe inferiorly. So this area is called the caudate process. Now let's consider the peritoneal relations of the liver. If you see, the peritoneum is surrounding almost the entire liver except for few places. If you see, this is actually the glistening thing. What you are seeing is actually the visceral peritoneum, which is covering the liver anteriorly. Once it comes towards the posterior aspect, okay, towards the posterior aspect, it reflects back to the diaphragm. Okay, it reflects back to the diaphragm and it will surround the, and it will be covering the under surface of the diaphragm, okay, inferior surface of the diaphragm. So the peritoneum is coming like this and reflecting back to the diaphragm, okay, on either side. Okay, it is reflecting back to the diaphragm. Similarly, it is covering the right surface and also the inferior surface. When it is covering like that, the peritoneum will not be covering few regions. The most important part of it is present along the posterior surface of the right lobe. You can see this. This is the area where the peritoneum is not covered. Okay. This area is called the bare area of liver. Okay. This area is called the bare area of liver, which is present along the posterior aspect of the right lobe of liver. This area is bounded by the upper and the lower layer of the coronary ligaments. So these coronary ligaments are nothing but the peritoneal reflections, which are coming and reflecting onto the diaphragm. Okay. So once it is reflecting back, this layer of peritoneum, which is reflecting back superiorly, is called the coronary ligaments. Okay. The superior and the inferior coronary ligaments, and it will be ending on the sides. Okay. As triangular ligaments. Okay. And it will be ending on the sides, ends as the triangular ligament. So the right triangular ligament. It is present between the superior and the inferior coronary ligament and also the right triangular ligament. Okay. So that is the bare area. The most important applied importance of this bare area is the portocaval anastomosis. This is an important site for portocaval anastomosis. Both the portal and the systemic veins will be anastomosing at this bare area. Okay. So this is an important site for portocaval anastomosis. So other than bare area of the liver, we have few more places where there is no peritoneal covering of for the liver. We'll study those places. Okay, the next place where there is no peritoneal covering is the groove for inferior vena cava. So if you see the groove for the inferior vena cava, so this is the groove. Okay, this is the groove for inferior vena cava. So here there is no peritoneal covering because the peritoneum is reflecting anterior, is reflecting posterior to that of the inferior vena cava, surrounding posteriorly. So the groove will not be having the peritoneal covering. Okay, then next is go inferiorly, we can see this porta hepatis. So this porta hepatis also will not have the peritoneal covering. Okay, the main area of the porta hepatis will not have the peritoneal covering because the peritoneum will be reflected along the vessels, mainly the portal vein, hepatic artery, bile duct. Okay, so there won't be peritoneal covering in the porta hepatis. Next important region is the gallbladder. Okay, fossa, gallbladder fossa. So the peritoneum is covering over inferior to the gallbladder. So if in anatomical position, it is covering inferior to the gallbladder. So this gallbladder fossa also will not be so having peritoneal covering. So you can see we can't strip off the gallbladder from the liver. Okay, it is very closely adherent. So there is no peritoneal covering in the gallbladder fossa. These are the areas where there are no peritoneal coverings for the liver. Next, we'll study about the peritoneal ligaments. Okay, peritoneal ligaments. If you see the peritoneum, the layers which are reflecting back to the diaphragm will be called as ligaments. Okay, these are all peritoneal ligaments. Okay, these are all not true ligaments. It's just a peritoneal reflections. What you're seeing, this is actually the superior coronary ligament. So we have the coronary ligaments. Okay, the two coronary ligaments on both right and the left side will fuse on the right and the left ends of the liver to form triangular ligaments. Okay, these are the left, this is the left triangular ligament, and here we have the right triangular ligament, which is not seen here because the peritoneum is, the layer is missing here. Okay, so it will present a right triangular ligament and it will present the left triangular ligament. Okay, the two coronary ligaments joined together to form the right and the left triangular ligaments. Next is the falciform ligament. We can see the peritoneum, which is reflected back to the anterior abdominal wall, okay, is the falciform ligament. Okay, this is actually the falciform ligament, which is very important ligament, which will be separating the right and the left lobe of the liver. Next, let's see two more important ligaments which are related to the liver. One is this one, ligamentum teres. Okay, this ligamentum teres will be extending up to the umbilicus. Okay, so this is actually nothing but embryological remnant, or embryologically it is actually related to the obliterated left umbilical vein. Okay, it is related to the left umbilical vein, and this ligament is formed because of the obliteration of the left umbilical vein. Okay, next, if you follow this, we can see this is a groove for ligamentum venosum. This ligamentum venosum, which is present here, is nothing but the obliterated ductus venosus. Okay, obliterated ductus venosus. These two structures are related embryologically, and it is related to the blood supply. It is related to the fetal circulation. Okay, it is related to the fetal circulation to carry the oxygenated blood. Okay, to the These vessels which are in the fetus will help to carry the oxygenated blood from the fetus to that of the inferior vena cava. Okay, to that of the inferior vena cava during fetal life. Okay, during fetal life. Now let's see the porta hepatis. So this area where all the structures either enter or leave the liver is called the porta hepatis. This porta hepatis has got the following stages. This is the posterior aspect, this is the anterior aspect. So posteriorly we have this large vein. This is actually the portal vein. Okay, this is actually the portal vein. Okay, formed by the union of, see, the superior mesenteric and the splenic vein. Okay, this is actually the portal vein. So anterior to the portal vein we have the bile duct. This is actually the bile duct and the hepatic artery. Okay, bile duct and hepatic artery, these are the main structures which are present in the porta hepatis. Other than these structures, there are lymphatics and there are nerves which are entering. The nerves will be entering and the lymphatics will be coming out of the liver. So that is about porta hepatis. Then about the hepatic veins. The hepatic veins will directly drain into the inferior vena cava along the posterior aspect. If you see the posterior aspect, you can see there are multiple openings which are coming from the liver directly, and it is opening into the inferior vena cava. okay, and it is draining into the inferior. You can see here one, and this is another one here. So all are opening directly into, this is actually the main inferior vena cava opening, okay. All are draining directly into the inferior vena cava. And these are called the hepatic veins. These are the hepatic veins. This forms one of the important support for the liver also. This also will form one of the important support other than this ligament. This forms very important support for the liver. So that liver can be placed in its anatomical position. Now coming to the relations of the liver. You see the anterior surface, it is mainly related in the midline to that of the xiphoid process and also the ribs and the diaphragm, okay. The chest cavity and the chest wall and the anterior chest wall and also the diaphragm. If you go superiorly, it is mainly related to the diaphragm, which separates it from the thoracic cavity, okay. It will be separating it from the thoracic cavity. Here, this area, you have a concave region on the superior aspect, okay. This concave part will be lodging the heart, okay. So that's why we have a small concave depression here, okay. Okay, so this is called the cardiac impression, okay. Cardiac, on either side of the cardiac impression, so the diaphragm separates the liver from that of the pleural cavity and the lungs, okay. Next is the right surface. This right surface is mainly related to the diaphragm and it will be related to the ribs, 7th to the 11th rib, okay. It will be extending from the 7th to 11th rib, okay. That is about the right surface. That is about the right surface. Now anterior surface, superior and the right surface is over. Now let's study about the main surface, the visceral surface or the inferior surface. This is the inferior surface or the visceral surface, okay. It is related to the following visceras. If you see the inferior aspect of the right lobe, it is mainly related to the stomach, okay. So this is actually the impression of the stomach, okay. Followed by, if you go to this area, this lobe is called the quadrate lobe, okay. The quadrate lobe is mainly related to the end of the stomach, that is actually the pyloric part of stomach. Along with the pyloric part, we also have the first part of the duodenum, okay. The pyloric part of the stomach and the first part of the duodenum. So you can remember anatomically the structures in order, okay. From the left, we have the stomach followed by the pyloric end of the stomach, then the first part of duodenum, okay. Then you go little more towards the right lobe, okay. Inferior aspect of the right lobe, we get the second part of the duodenum, okay. The first part, then the beginning of the second part of the duodenum, okay. Then if you see, you can see a fossa here with the organ, okay. This is actually the gallbladder fossa, which is located in the gallbladder fossa. That is the next visceral relation, okay. Next, if you come to the right lobe, okay, it is related to right colic flexure, okay. The right colic flexure, this area is a right colic flexure, okay. Right colic flexure, then more posteriorly, this is a posterior aspect, okay. So more posteriorly, we have the impression for the right kidney, okay. Impression for the right kidney. And this quadrate lobe, anteriorly, it is also related to the transverse colon. Okay, anteriorly, it is also related to transverse colon. These are the visceral relations of the inferior aspect of liver, which is very important. Now, we have only one more surface, that is the posterior surface. So, this is the posterior surface. The posterior surface is related to, from the left side, it is related to, this area will be related to the esophagus, okay. This area will be related to esophagus, okay. You can see the esophagus comes like this and it produces stomach in the inferior aspect, okay. So this area is related to esophagus. Then we have the crurus of diaphragm, which will be related to this quadrate lobe, okay. Along near the vena cava, there will be crurus of diaphragm. Next we can see the inferior vena cava, which is related posteriorly, okay. Near the lower part of the inferior vena cava groove, okay, groove for inferior vena cava, this area will be related to the right suprarenal gland, okay. This area will be related to right suprarenal gland. So these are all the important relations of the liver. Next, coming to the blood supply, if you see the blood supply, 20% of the blood to the liver is brought about by this hepatic artery, okay. This common proper hepatic artery, okay. So it is coming from the celiac trunk, okay. So it's coming, the main source is from the celiac trunk. Through the common hepatic artery, 20% of the blood is reaching the liver. Rest 80% of the blood is reaching the liver via the portal vein, okay. Via the portal vein. Next is the venous drainage of liver. Venous drainage of liver is via the hepatic veins. We have seen the hepatic veins. There are up to three large hepatic veins will be opening into the upper part of the inferior vena cava. Okay, upper part of the groove in the inferior vena cava, and there are some sets of lower groups of small hepatic veins which will be draining into the inferior vena cava. That is about the venous drainage. So this is about the gross features of liver.